In this lecture, we'll learn where in our galaxy stars form and why they form in the first place. Within the disk of our galaxy are vast clouds of gas and dust from which stars are born. These are the stellar nurseries of the Milky Way. Star formation is a common process. An average of 2 to 3 stars are born somewhere in the Milky Way galaxy each year. The dark patches we see in the disk of the Milky Way are interstellar gas clouds, the raw material for star formation. We often think of space as being empty. It certainly has less stuff than what we're used to on Earth, but it's not completely empty. There's at least a little gas and dust in between the stars. This gas and dust is referred to as the interstellar medium. It's mostly helium and hydrogen with a small amount of heavier elements. Stars are born in particularly cold and dense interstellar clouds known as molecular clouds. Within these clouds, atoms are able to combine together into molecules like carbon monoxide, ammonia, ethyl alcohol, and molecular hydrogen. The molecular hydrogen is actually difficult to detect, but we can study molecular clouds by looking for the carbon monoxide. There is not a lot of it, but it does produce radio emission lines that allow us to map structures in the clouds. This image shows radio emission from carbon monoxide molecules between stars in our galaxy. Not all the material in a molecular cloud is gaseous. About 1% of the molecular cloud's mass is made up of tiny solid grains of interstellar dust. Despite the tiny size of these grains, there are enough of them that they can affect how light travels through a molecular cloud. The dust grains either scatter or absorb the visible light that enters a cloud, preventing us from seeing any stars that lie behind it. Also, the edges of a molecular cloud look more red because dust blocks shorter wavelength blue light more effectively than longer wavelength red light. Long wavelength infrared light passes through a cloud more easily than visible light. Therefore, observations in infrared light can reveal stars on the other side of the cloud. For example, the constellation Orion looks much different in the infrared. The bright region below the belt stars is an area of active star formation. And here is another example where observing the infrared light from a cloud can reveal a newborn star embedded inside it. This is a portion of the Eagle Nebula known as the Pillars of Creation. New stars are being born here. We can see thermal radiation in the infrared, and at slightly shorter infrared wavelengths, the pillars become almost transparent. Now that we can see star formation, it makes sense to ask, why is it happening? Stars form when gravity causes a molecular cloud to contract, and the contraction continues until the central object becomes hot enough to sustain nuclear fusion. But gravity can create stars only if it can overcome the outward push of thermal pressure within the gas cloud. As the cloud shrinks, thermal pressure gets larger, like squeezing a balloon. The gravitational contraction also converts some of the cloud's gravitational potential energy into thermal energy. If the cloud cannot get rid of the thermal energy quickly, then it builds up inside the cloud, raising the cloud's temperature and thermal pressure, and eventually bringing the process of star formation to a halt. Molecular clouds can overcome this pressure by transforming the thermal energy into radio and infrared photons. As long as the photons can escape the cloud's temperature can remain low and gravity can dominate over thermal pressure. Observations show that most stars are born in large clusters. It's simply easier for gravity to overcome thermal pressure in a high-mass molecular cloud. For gravity to win in these clouds, we need a mass of at least a few hundred times the mass of the Sun. Most star-forming clouds are actually thousands of times the mass of the Sun. We get multiple stars from a cloud because of fragmentation. As a gas cloud condenses and becomes more dense, the gravity within the cloud becomes stronger. Molecular clouds are turbulent and lumpy, so there are plenty of small clumps within a contracting cloud that are able to shrink on their own. Therefore, a large cloud will split into numerous individual cloud fragments, and each of these fragments will go on to become a star system. Gravity can overcome pressure in a relatively small cloud if the cloud is unusually dense. Even a cloud with just a few solar masses of material can form a single star, as long as the cloud is sufficiently dense and cool. If we go far enough back in time, the composition of interstellar gas must have been different because virtually all elements heavier than helium have been produced inside of stars. The very oldest stars in our galaxy don't have many elements heavier than helium because this first generation of stars was born before the heavy elements had been made. The first stars formed from clouds of gas containing only hydrogen and helium from the Big Bang. It would have been harder for these clouds to radiate away thermal energy, so the clouds were warmer and more massive than the star-forming clouds we see now. The massive clouds would have created massive stars that already used up their fuel and died off. That's it for now. Enjoy the rest of your day or your night. I will talk to you again soon.